The Complete Works of Swami Vivekananda, Mission of the Vedanta, an address by Swamiji to the residents of Kumbakonam in 1897, Part 3. It is a curious fact that while nations after nations have come upon the stage of the world, played their parts vigorously for a few moments, and died almost without leaving a mark or a ripple on the ocean of time, here we are living, as it were, an eternal life. They talk a great deal of the new theories about survival of the fittest, and they think that it is the strength of the muscles which is the fittest to survive. If that were true, any one of the aggressively known old world nations would have lived in glory today. And we, the weak Hindus, who never conquered even one race or nation, ought to have died out. Yet we live here 300 million strong. A young English lady once told me, "What have the Hindus done? They never even conquered a single race." And it is not at all true that all its energies are spent, that entropy has overtaken its body. That is not true. There is vitality enough, and when it comes out in torrents, it deluges the world when the time is ripe and it is required. We have, as it were, thrown a challenge to the whole world from the most ancient times. In the West, they are now trying to solve the problem how much a man can possess. And we are here trying to solve the problem on how little a man can live. This struggle and this difference will still go on for some centuries. But if history has any truth in it, and if prognostications ever prove true, it must be that those who train themselves to live on the least and control themselves well will in the end gain in battle, and that those who run after enjoyment and luxury, however vigorous they may seem at the moment, will have to die and become annihilated. There are times in the history of a man's life, nay, in the history of the lives of nations, when a sort of world weariness becomes painfully predominant. It seems that such a tide of world weariness has come upon the Western world. They too, they have their thinkers, great men, and they are already finding out that this race after gold and power is all vanities of vanities. Many, nay most of the cultured men and women there are already weary of this competition, this struggle, this brutality of their commercial civilization, and they are looking forward towards something better. There is a class which still clings on to political and social changes as the only panacea for the evils in Europe. But among the great thinkers there, other ideals are growing. They have found out that no amount of political or social manipulation of human conditions can cure the evils of life. It is a change of the soul itself for the better that alone will cure the evils of life. No amount of force or government or legislative cruelty will change the conditions of a race. But it is spiritual culture and ethical culture alone that can change wrong racial tendencies for the better. Thus, these races of the West are eager for some new thought, for some new philosophy. The religion they had, Christianity, although good and glorious in many respects, has been imperfectly understood and is, as understood hitherto, found to be insufficient. The thoughtful men of the West find in our ancient philosophy, especially in the Vedanta, the new impulse of thought that they are seeking. The very spiritual food and drink for which they are hungering and thirsting. And it is no wonder that it is so. I have become used to hear all sorts of wonderful claims put forward in favor of every religion under the sun. You have also heard, quite within recent times, the claims put forward by Dr. Barrows, a great friend of mine, that Christianity is the only universal religion. Let me consider this question a while and lay before you my reasons why I think that it is Vedanta and Vedanta alone that can become the universal religion of man, and that no other is fitted for that role. Excepting our own, almost all the other great religions in the world are inevitably connected with the life or lives of one or more of their founders. All their theories, their teachings, their doctrines and their ethics are built around the life of a personal founder from whom they get their sanction, their authority and their power. And strangely enough, upon the historicity of the founder's life is built, as it were, all the fabric of such religions. And if there is one blow dealt to the historicity of that life, as has been the case in modern times with the lives of almost all the so-called founders of religions, we know that half of the details of such lives is not now seriously believed in, and the other half is seriously doubted. If this becomes the case, if that rock of historicity, as they pretended it to call it, is shaken and shattered, the whole building tumbles down, broken absolutely, never to regain its lost status.